Hi, let's talk about the arteries of the upper limb. Our adventure will begin with the subclavian artery, which on the right side is a branch of the brachiocephalic trunk, and on the left side is a direct branch of the arch of the aorta. The subclavian artery has three distinct parts, which can all be found relative to their position to the anterior scalene muscle. The anterior scalene muscle attaches from transverse processes of cervical vertebrae to the first rib. The first part of the subclavian artery is found medial to the anterior scalene muscle, and it has three branches. There's the vertebral artery, the internal thoracic artery, and the thyrocervical trunk. The vertebral artery is going to ascend the neck through the transverse foramina of cervical vertebrae 6 through 1 before entering the skull through foramen magnum, where it joins its counterpart vertebral artery to form the basilar artery. This basilar artery is going to supply the brain with blood, and it will have potential anastomoses with the internal carotid arteries, which are the other major blood supply to the brain. The internal thoracic artery is going to supply the anterior and lateral aspects of the wall of the thorax as well as the abdomen with blood. And the thyrocervical trunk has four major branches. There's the inferior thyroid artery, which serves the thyroid gland, the parathyroid glands, and the larynx with blood. The ascending cervical artery, which supplies deep neck muscles, such as the anterior scalene muscle with blood. There's the transverse cervical artery, which supplies trapezius with blood. And then there's the suprascapular artery, which supplies some of the rotator cuff muscles, namely supraspinatus and infraspinatus with blood. We can't see the second part of the subclavian artery because it is occluded or behind the anterior scalene muscle. But there is a small trunk there called the costocervical trunk, which has two major branches. There's a deep cervical artery, which supplies some of the deep neck muscles with blood, and then a supreme intercostal artery, which supplies the first and second intercostal spaces with blood. The third part of the subclavian artery runs from that lateral border of anterior scalene out to the lateral border of the first rib. And there's typically one branch from this called the dorsal scapular artery. Here we can see the dorsal scapular artery moving between the middle and the superior trunks of the brachial plexus. That dorsal scapular artery can from time to time be a branch from the transverse cervical artery, but it's typically conceived of as a branch of the third part of the subclavian artery. And this dorsal scapular artery is going to serve some of the muscles that attach to the medial border of the scapula, things like levator scapulae and the rhomboids muscles, rhomboid major and minor with blood, and it will be an important component of the scapular anastomoses. Beyond the lateral border of rib 1 is the axillary artery, which we can see next. So the axillary artery is going to traverse the axilla. It's going to have a special relationship with the brachial plexus, so it's going to be intermingled with elements of the brachial plexus. And you'll probably learn or have already learned in the neuro block how different parts of the brachial plexus get their name owing to their relative position to the axillary artery. Well, just as the subclavian artery had three parts, the axillary artery also has three parts, and these parts are designated by their relationship to the pectoralis minor muscle, which we can see its attachment there. So the first part of the axillary artery is going to be medial to pec minor, and there is one branch known as the superior thoracic artery. The superior thoracic artery is going to supply blood to some of the intercostal spaces of the lateral wall of the thorax. The second part of the axillary artery is going to be behind pectoralis minor muscle. And there are two major branches here. There's the thoracoacromial artery. This thoracoacromial artery is going to supply quite a few structures with blood. Subclavius, pectoralis major, pectoralis minor, there are branches to the deltoid muscle. So it does quite a bit of blood supply to the general axillary region. The other muscle is the lateral thoracic artery. Lateral thoracic artery is descending down the lateral aspect of the thorax to supply serratus anterior with blood. And then we move on to the third part of the axillary artery, which has three major branches. So this third part will be lateral to pectoralis minor, and it will be medial or superior to teres major muscle, which we can see there. And there are the three major branches. The first is the subscapular artery. Subscapular artery has two branches. There's the thoracoacromial artery. Thoracoacromial artery is going to be the major blood supply to latissimus dorsi, which we can see there. And then we have the circumflex scapular artery, which is going to come around the lateral border of the scapula. This is going to serve some of those rotator cuff muscles with blood and anastomose with dorsal scapular artery and suprascapular artery. So if we think about the scapula as sort of a triangle here, we have circumflex scapular coming around that side. We have dorsal scapular riding down that side, and then suprascapular coming down that way. And these three arteries can provide some rather extensive anastomoses about the scapula. Well, also coming off this third part of the axillary artery are going to be the circumflex humeral arteries. There's a posterior and an anterior. These are going to wrap around the neck of the humerus. There's the anterior circumflex humeral artery. There's the posterior circumflex humeral artery. The posterior circumflex humeral artery is transmitted through the quadrangular space and is usually accompanied typically by the axillary nerve, which is a branch of the brachial plexus. And these two circumflex humeral arteries are going to supply the proximal humerus with blood, but they're the predominant blood supply to the deltoid muscle. Once we get beyond teres major here, we're no longer in the axillary artery, but we're in the brachial artery. And here we can see the first branch of the brachial artery, which is the deep brachial artery, and then a continuation of the brachial artery down the arm. That deep brachial artery is going to be the dominant blood supply to the posterior compartment of the arm. So think triceps brachii. Whereas the brachial artery will be the dominant blood supply to the anterior compartment of the arm. So biceps brachii, coracobrachialis, etc. That brachial artery is going to ramify into the radial and the ulnar artery. So usually it's just proximal to the antecubital fossa where we have this split. And so there is the radial artery and there is the ulnar artery. The radial artery is going to travel down the lateral aspect of the forearm. The ulnar artery is going to travel deep but predominantly medial down the forearm. Over here, we've stripped away a lot of the muscles of the forearm to better visualize that. And let me show you what's going on here. So there's the brachial artery, and then there's the division for the radial and the ulnar arteries. So that radial artery travels down the forearm, and about there in the wrist is where we would palpate the radial pulse. And it goes deep into the hand, where it gives rise to the deep palmar arch. The ulnar artery is going down the medial aspect of the forearm, and it gives off a short branch called the common interosseous artery. That common interosseous artery divides into an anterior and a posterior interosseous artery. So there's the anterior, and there's the posterior. These are on opposite sides of the interosseous membrane that connects the radius and the ulna of the forearm. And they're going to supply, well, the anterior will supply the deep flexor compartment of the forearm. And the posterior is going to supply the deeper parts of the extensor compartment of the forearm. Now that ulnar artery, when it gets to the hand, is going to give rise to the superficial palmar arterial arch. And the deep and the superficial palmar arterial arches will very frequently anastomose. They don't always. Sometimes there is distinct patterns of vascularization to the hand where there are not anastomoses. But if there are good collateral blood flow to the hand through anastomoses between these palmar arches, that frees up the radial artery for harvesting for other purposes or cannulation for various cardiac procedures, if necessary. One way that I remember that the ulnar artery gives rise to the superficial palmar arch is that superficial has a U in it. U is for ulnar. So that is the overview of the arteries of the upper limb. So starting with the subclavian artery and its branches, the axillary artery and its branches, the brachial artery and its branches, and then finally ending with the radial and ulnar artery branches that typically anastomose through the deep and superficial palmar arterial arches. Thank you very much for your time.